Hey, you geeks! I tried Dresden again. Since everyone says that Dresden gets better the further it goes, I decided to skip book 3 and go straight to book 4, Summer Night.
The summer night.
I do not regret it. Maybe I'll go back and read book 3 eventually, but I don't feel like I missed much. An early Dresden in a vampire war? Ugh. Summer Night gives us the highlights and also throws Dresden in a high-stakes fairy war. I usually hate it when basic PI series slide into epic drama, but Dresden was an awkward fit in low-stakes murder mystery. Summer Night finally gives Dresden room to show his stuff, not hampered by silly things like criminal procedure. Dresden in Over His Head is so much more likable. He's still not my favorite character in fiction, but he's getting better.
Better. Not good, but better.
On to spoilers. Characters. Summer Night has a fun cast. We get the returning cast, Billy and the Alphas, and Murphy, of course. Our suspects are quite unusual. Fairy queens, knights, and wizardly wizards, oh my. By far, my favorites were the changelings. Dresden. Real men talk about their feelings. He starts as a wreck and slowly pulls himself together. I like that arc. I never really shipped him and Susan, but seeing Harry all messed up over her demise made me start to care about their relationship.
Don't it always seem to go that you don't know what you got till it's gone?
We get a lot of Dresden's love life. Finally meeting Little Miss totally did not die in the fire, femme fatale Elaine, who actually turned out to be a good person, despite betraying Dresden twice. At first, I thought she was just there to be a distressing damsel.
Rather, damsel in distress, either one.
Then she and Harry get a whole arc where, what do you know, they part ways as unlikely friends. Speaking of unlikely friends, Harry and Murphy finally opened up to each other, then kicked some crenofiend ash. This sold me on their friendship. I don't think I could take another book of them being frenemies.
Trust you, maybe I'll trust you.
Harry finally has enough personality to have real friends. Dresden's fledgling friendships make him seem like a real person and less like a wizard detective caricature. Merrill, by far the best character in this book. And the first female Dresden describes as ugly. Here I was thinking that Dresden is easily impressed, but no, even he has standards.
I guess so. She's got a great personality.
Ew.
Since we aren't treated to how voluptuous she is, we get to learn about her personality. Of course, it's great. I even cared about Lily because of how much Meryl cared. Also, her whole impending She-Hulk demise was quite moving, even if she was only there to confirm that Faye can die. World building. The elusive White Council finally takes the stage. There is nothing like internal politics to explain the Council's seemingly erratic behavior. A cross between the United Nations and the Charity Board, the White Council is a beautiful bureaucratic mess.
Are you running a business or a charity ward?
It also shows off the many forms magic can take, which was nice after the first three books taking the garden variety demons, vampires, and werewolves, oh my. I enjoyed seeing the hints at different cultural takes on magic. We get Gandalf's medicine men and straight up rednecks. The fairy courts also fleshed out the Never Never.
Take my hand, cross the Never Never Land.
Rather than an amorphous hell-like pit, the Never Never has many realms, complete with grass, toadstools, and killer trees. Dresden's main adventure is a very English romp. According to Wikipedia, C.S. Lewis made the stone table folkloric, though ancient altars for blood sacrifices were generally stone the world over. The changelings and their choice to be either fully mortal or fully fae felt very Tolkienian, very Elrond and Elros. Also, I could swear the cuss, stars and stones, comes from Gondor. But it also seems very wizardly. Butcher builds off the classics we already know, or maybe were taught and slept through, to build his fairy realms. He credits Spencer with describing Queen Mab, but Spencer's fairy queen was named Gloriana. Mercutio raves about Mab in Romeo and Juliet, and J.M. Barrie wrote about her in The Little White Bird. Though Shakespeare named his fairy queen in Summer Titania, Mab and Titania were interchangeable names for one queen. Butcher tells us his version of the fairies with such certainty I could almost believe they ruled our world as well. Magic. Dresden magic still seems quite simple, or rather, Dresden has a simple understanding of magic. There are rules, however,
is more what you'd call guidelines than actual rules.
Butcher uses this simplicity to encapsulate all different types of magic, each operating according to its own nature. That works, except I do not understand the nature of Butcher's fairies. Queen Mab hints that she is not free and envies humans' ability to be so. She tells the fox and scorpion fable to say that all things are bound by their nature. It is summer and winter's nature to be constantly at war. Now, simple Neoplatonist me infers that when a being is acting in accord with their nature, they are happy.
Life is so unnerving for a servant who's not serving.
Humans get sick of perpetual war because human nature is not made for it. What human nature is beyond the scope of this video. But fairy nature ain't human. Aurora's nature is to fight this war, so she should be having a marvelous time. Why does she hurt? The answer that she's loopier than a crochet convention doesn't satisfy me. Also about fairies, Butcher barely conveyed that a fairy could die. Peter Pan rules don't seem to apply.
Every time someone says, I do not believe in fairies, somewhere there's a fairy that falls down dead.
So I wasn't sure that they could. They didn't like iron, but I never got the impression it could kill them. Until boom, Meryl was dead. Then boom, Aurora was dead. My sadness was only outmatched by my confusion. Plot. Attempted assassination is a much better action novel opening than Dresden leering at a woman's behind. We get that in the second chapter, but Mab preemptively stabbed him. So I guess they're square. Then off to the Wizards Council. Good bureaucratic drama is hard to convey in an action series. Throw in some Latin faulty translation and enough magic to turn tension into a literal time bomb, things start to get interesting. Warden Morgan's gung-ho persecution of Dresden does defy logic, but some people are just jerks.
When I dig up the proof, real or otherwise, that you're the traitor that I know you are, then I'll know it and you'll know it too.
Dresden's job as a fairy queen's private eye fits his unique qualifications much better than working for mob bosses and worried housewives. The actual mystery wasn't that mysterious. Mav tried her hedonistic psychopath impersonation, which was an excellent modernizing of the myths, but some details I could really live without. English fairies are quite phallic. I saw A Midsummer Night's Dream on stage back when theaters were a thing, and can still remember certain costume choices, or lack of costume choices. Butcher gives the reader the same flavor in writing, but draping Mab in this flamboyant red flag made her a more obvious red herring.
No, communism was just a red herring.
Meanwhile, Aurora first lies to Dresden, impersonating a mere fairy maiden, then when she's found out, flattening Dresden with a gentle touch of her hand. Even though she was so sweet, it was clear who was more dangerous. The final battle among the clouds was cool. The werewolves and pixies get some epic payoff, and Dresden gets to save the day. I'll assume that killing sentient fairies from the Never Never does not count as violating wizard law. All in all, Summer Night is a well-balanced meal. It's not quite my taste, but it's still good. Thank you for watching. Please like, share, and subscribe if you would like to see more. Your patronage is greatly appreciated.